Hey viewers, my name's Kara. I'm your host for Tuesdays on The Pagan Perspective, and this week we're talking about altars and ritual attire. There were actually two different questions this week from two different people, but breaking it down, it seems to me that they actually asked two questions each, so I see it as being four questions being answered today. What is a good location to set up an altar? Is there a size restriction for an altar with a circle around it? Talking about clothes of the craft, and then what do I personally wear when casting? The first questions are about altars. So, firstly, a little vocabulary lesson. This is something that I posted on my Tumblr a year or more ago.
Alter your altar. Alter. A-L-T-E-R. Transitive verb. To make different without changing into something else. Alter. A-L-T-A-R. Noun. A usually raised structure or place on which sacrifices are offered or incense is burned in worship.
So the first part of the question is what's a good place to set up an altar because they live with their parents. I have always lived with other people as well. I have had altars in a ton of different locations, and so what I'm going to do is walk you around the house where I currently live. And even though, keep in mind, my grandma lives here with me, so these are not places that I would personally take over in her house to put an altar, but these are ideas of where, if you had a whole house to yourself, or if you have furniture similar to this, or any sort of thing, just ideas for places that I would personally use as an altar. I don't have any permanent altars set up. I always use a temporary type format. I set it up when I do it. I take everything down, mostly because I do as many things as I can outside, and I don't have a permanent location outside to do that, so I bring things with me, set it up, do whatever I'm gonna do, take it back down. So as I walk you around, you'll notice that everything is not in use currently, but that's because I usually just clear it off and use it as I need it.
My room is kind of messy, but I sort of have an altar on this bedside table. I also have a table over here, which is covered in stuff right now, but I have used that as an altar. I have also used either one of my dressers as altars in the past. Any one of these little shelves could be a mini altar. My grandma has a sort of altar on top of her dresser. She also has a little shelf over here with just some statues on it. Earlier today, I noticed this tiny little shelf we have up in the corner with some pictures, and I thought that would be a nice place for a little shrine. On a shelf of your desk, or on top of your desk. On top of an entertainment center, and yes, those are pictures of me. We also have this cool little partial wall over here that's made up of shelves, and any of these little shelves could be a nice mini altar. Also, this thing where our phone is, pretty much anywhere where I think people would usually display pictures could also be a nice place for an altar, because it's out of the way, people don't usually mess around with it. I know someone who keeps an altar in a cupboard so that you can close the door and keep kids and animals and things from getting into it. Downstairs, where all my stuff is, this is a table that I've used as an altar, and this is my bookshelf, which I frequently use the top part as a sort of altar. I have this long table that I use as an altar. A little hanging shelf like this, it's a mirror with a hanging basket, something like that you could use. But of course, whenever I can, my altars are outside.
As for size restrictions, there are definitely some things that you'll read about how big a circle usually is and things like that. I know that I read in a few books on Wicca that traditionally a Wiccan circle is 9 feet in diameter. And at first I always thought like, oh, my room isn't 9 feet long, how am I gonna do that? But then after a while I realized that's because traditional covens have covens, and they're multiple people, so you need more room to fit everyone in that circle comfortably. So for me, working mostly as a solitary, usually my circle is no bigger than I need it to be. However big the altar is, and then, you know, an aisle of sorts around the altar so that I can walk around it comfortably. And then I just started making my circles as big as the room that I was actually in. So if I was in my fairly small bedroom, instead of trying to make it a certain size, I would just make it the size of my whole room. So whatever that is to you. But the word restriction makes me think, I don't know, maybe you want to make it in a huge, huge circle, and you're wondering if there's any restriction on how big it can be. I personally would not make it so enormously big, like bigger than you need, because I think most people who use circles for their magic workings and things like that, we use it to help us contain the energy that we're raising until we're ready to release it. And so it's just like trying to heat or cool a room. You know, the bigger the room is, the longer you have to leave the heater on to fill up the entire room, or the air conditioning, same thing. If you're in a tiny tiny little room, then it'll warm up or cool down really quickly. So the bigger your circle is, the longer it's gonna take you to fill all of that up with energy, and it's never going to feel really heavy or bursting with energy. But if your circle is just big enough that everyone needs it, you'll be able to contain that energy and actually feel when it's ready to be released. So that would be the only restriction for me. I wouldn't want to make it so big that it takes us forever to fill it up. Second person's questions about ritual attire, things that we wear. They said, could we talk about clothes of the craft and what we wear when casting? And to me, those are actually two different things. Clothes of the craft sounds like what clothes do witches wear and what clothes do druids wear and things like that. Not necessarily an individual what do I wear. I was going to show you a diagram in a book because I thought I read it in a book that I had, but maybe it was online. I don't know where it was now because I looked in the books that I thought it was in and it's not there. But what I think of when you say clothes of the craft, number one, is this diagram that I read somewhere for just a basic ritual garment, which was just, I'll put a little picture of it on the screen, I'll do a drawing in paint. But basically, you know, you just measure yourself, the length of your arms, how tall you are, how long you want it to be, your waist measurement, your shoulders, and then you cut just a basic robe shape and sew it together very simply. But something like that is what I think of when you say clothes of the craft, or robes. A lot of people like to wear robes of different colors, which would be really easy to make. A lot of people might even go out and buy those Halloween costume fake crushed velvet robes, and I don't really recommend that. Because I have those robes too, but I'm just saying I don't wear those robes in ritual, I wear those as a costume. But yeah, I think robes could be considered simple garments made of natural materials. Skyclad is traditional for a lot of groups, which of course is ritual nudity. Some people have specific jewelry that they wear for ritual and they don't wear it any other time. Things like that. So that's what I think of when you say clothes of the craft. Personally, what do I wear when I cast? I wear just about anything. You know, there are some times where I'll just be around the house lounging and I'm like, I want to go downstairs and do a little working for something, and I won't necessarily change my clothes to do it. I'll just wear whatever I have on, whether it's jeans and a t-shirt or a nice little dress or what I'm wearing today, different like tank tops, and I'm wearing gaucho pants right now, stretch pants. So if I'm just like around the house or doing something casual, I won't necessarily change my clothes for it. But when I go to an event, I usually like to wear something that I feel looks naturey or looks pagan-y, which would just be kind of things like this, sort of natural, I don't know, nature colors. I have this really great dress that my brother bought me, which is wonderful. It has this kind of design on it, but it's a black bodice dress. The bottom of the dress flares out and it's kind of like orange and brown and a little bit of yellow. It looks like fall leaves to me. So I wore that to the Mabon ritual that I went to last year. Because I have some dresses that I wear to the medieval fair that I've worn for ritual. If I'm choosing something to wear specifically for ritual, I'll choose something that matches the color of what I want to do. One ritual I remember last summer, I wanted to do it at 2 a.m. and go out in the field across from my house. So I just threw on whatever little simple soft dress I had lying around and just put my boots on and went out. I have done some personal rituals skyclad in my own room where I know that I will not be disturbed or seen by outsiders. I've never done that outside because I've never lived in a situation where I have enough private land to myself that I know no one else is going to be like seeing me and being like, what the heck is she doing? Because I've always had neighbors and here I have my family. I don't have any specific jewelry that I wear only for ritual and never wear it ever again. Like, I wear this on a daily basis and I would choose to wear this for ritual. Any of the other jewelry that I have that I may choose, oh, I want to wear this one for this ritual today, I wear that stuff on a daily basis as well. I don't have anything that's ritual only. Same thing goes for the clothes. Even though I may choose to wear that one dress that my brother got me that I love so much for rituals, I would wear that out to any other kind of event as well. So yeah, it depends on the ritual, whether it's just something casual that I'm doing here all of a sudden, or if it's an event that I'm actually going to. That's all I have for you this week, and I will see you next month, because you'll be hearing from the subs next week. Thank you very much for watching, and until next time, don't forget to be awesome, blessed be, and goodbye.